Hi, everyone. I'm really excited today to continue our partnership with Carbon Health and on the discussion of diabetes. And that's because November is Diabetes Awareness Month. And I'm joined today by Dr. Reddy, who is an endocrinologist of virtual diabetes care at Carbon Health. And I just want Dr. Reddy to give everybody a brief overview of some statistics related to diabetes.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. Pleased to be here. It's really mind-blowing to me because diabetes is just rising in epidemic proportions. I mean, we are seeing more and more individuals with diabetes. In fact, we now have about 37.3 million people in the United States that have diabetes. That's like 11.3% of the population. And sadly, about 23% of them don't even know that they have diabetes. And then when you look at pre-diabetes, which is kind of a precursor to diabetes, there's like 96 million people with pre-diabetes in the United States. That's about 38% of the population. So we're just having like a pandemic proportion explosion if this continues.
Yeah, those are some really huge numbers. And I know that there's a few different types of diabetes. So would you mind just touching on what those different types are?
Sure. The two major types are type 1 and type 2. And type 1 diabetes is where the pancreas that sits behind your stomach does not make any insulin at all. So these individuals need insulin injections to survive. And in fact, if they go more than 24 hours without insulin, they could go into a coma and not make it. With type 2 diabetes, which is more the more predominant form, in that case, the pancreas makes some insulin, but it's not enough. And there's a resistance to the way insulin works. And that's what about 90 to 95% of people with diabetes have. There's another variety called gestational diabetes, which, as the name implies, occurs during pregnancy, during that 24 to 28th week. And then there's also a fourth category where the diabetes can occur secondary to other conditions, like if you needed steroids for something, or if you had cystic fibrosis, or other disorders like MODY. Those could predispose to a different kind of diabetes.
So it really shows the importance of insulin in our bodies to help regulate our blood sugar levels. So that kind of comes to one of the questions from the audience, wondering if high blood sugar in our bloodstream can cause diabetes or plays a role in diabetes, what is it actually doing negatively to our bodies?
Great question. Normally when the pancreas is working, it's making insulin and that helps to metabolize our different foods and keep the glucose levels normal. So now when these glucose levels go up over 200, acutely you can have symptoms. So you could be urinating a lot because the glucose is so high. You could be feeling thirsty, just chugging down water, losing weight, or have blurry vision, or have infections, or just feel weak all over. So that's kind of like more acutely what happens when it goes up. Now, if you do have diabetes and the glucose levels are high over time, then that high glucose is now damaging your organs. So you can get eye damage that could lead to blindness. You could get damage of your nerve endings and get that thing called neuropathy, where you have numbness and tingling and can lose feeling in your feet or hands. It could also lead to heart attacks or strokes at an earlier age. It can also lead to kidney problems. So lots of bad things can happen when that blood sugar is high and not controlled.
Yeah, some serious symptoms that you were talking about. So that kind of leads into what are some of the treatment options for individuals with diabetes in order to avoid some of these really serious consequences.
You know, Dr. Rob, I should first point out one important point for those of the people who are listening. If you do have diabetes, it does not mean you're gonna get all these complications because we have treatments available. And if you keep those glucose under control, you can prevent many of those complications. So the treatment for diabetes really depends on what kind you have. If you have type 1, that's again where that pancreas wasn't making the insulin. So what we need to do is replace that hormone insulin that's no longer working. And the way to take insulin is usually in the form of injections. There is an inhaler and there's also a pump. But basically for a person with type 1, they need insulin. And that's given in different forms, injections, you could use inhaler or a pump. For somebody with type 2, the pancreas makes some insulin, but it's just not enough. So there are different things we could do. They could use different pills, there are injections, as well as they may need insulin as time goes on.
Now, there have been some individuals who mentioned that they had type 2 diabetes, and then eventually they were able to actually reverse this condition. So what does that actually look like? And how does somebody go about, you know, maybe potentially reversing their type 2 diabetes.
I'm really happy to hear that some of them were able to reverse it. And to be honest, the word reversing is a little bit of semantics. We don't like to use the word reversing because the defects, that is, that beta cells of the pancreas not working and the insulin resistance, are still there in those individuals with type 2 diabetes. So really what we like to do is call it a remission. And what we mean by that is that they changed their diet and lifestyle and made so many changes that they were able to get their glucose to normal. And that's what we would call a remission. If they got it to like pre-diabetes range, we would call it a partial remission. So really by changing your diet and lifestyle, oftentimes you can make those changes. You may need medications for a while, but it is possible to get to remission in some individuals that are newly diagnosed. There's also a phenomenon called glucotoxicity. And what that means is when the glucose levels are really high, think of it like kind of, I like to explain it to my patients as like kind of like that glucose is paralyzing everything so nothing can work and your pancreas can't work, it's in slow motion. So now if you get on insulin or medication or whatever your physician or endocrinologist thinks you need and you get those levels down, and I keep them that way for 4 weeks. Now my pancreas can start to work and you'll see some recovery of those beta cells. So oftentimes patients are able to, with diet or lifestyle, get their glucose levels to what looks like a normal range, but I wouldn't call it a reversal. It's more like they're in remission and that their glucose levels are staying in a really good optimal range where they are not at risk for complications.
Oh, I love that point, talking about going into remission, but still understanding that those individuals need to be careful and to continue those lifestyle changes in order to avoid having that come back.
And again, Dr. Rob, it's just, you know, not everybody will be able to go into remission. Mm-hmm. And luckily we have really good medications to treat type 2 diabetes. We have metformin, which has been used for many, many years, which is a pill. We have an injection called a GLP-1 receptor agonist. There are several of them out there. Semaglutide, dulaglutide, again, a bunch of different tirzepatide. There's different ones out there. But what they do is that group called GLP-1 receptor agonist replaces a hormone called GLP-1 that is no longer working as well in an individual with type 2 diabetes. So in a sense, you're giving a pharmacologic dose of this GLP-1 to help what is not working as well. And this then helps the person to lose some weight, keep their glucose level normal after meal. And similarly, we have another group of medicines for people with type 2 diabetes called an SGLT2 inhibitor, like empagliflozin is an example, but there are many in that class. And what happens is in individuals with type 2 diabetes, the kidneys hang on to sugar instead of getting rid of it. And these medications help the kidneys to get rid of sugar. So literally you're peeing out sugar. So you lose weight, but you also get your glucose under control. And both of these, the GLP-1 receptor agonist and the SGLT2 inhibitors, have been shown to have beneficial effects on preventing heart attacks and preventing kidney disease in individuals who are at high risk. So not only do they keep the glucose levels normal, but now we have something to help with those complications too. So again, many individuals will end up on medication, nothing bad about that. You need to take what is important to keep those glucose levels under control and prevent complications.
And I'm really happy that you brought up the medications, especially the ones that you mentioned are really focused on small molecules. So we're talking about actual chemical inhibitors or antagonists. And we had some questions from the audience actually curious going into the next stage of pharmacologics. So maybe looking at biologics or gene and replacement therapy. Is there anything that is coming out in the news related to those newer types of treatments that could be eventually used for diabetes?
Yeah, diabetes is a really exciting field to be in right now because there's a lot of new developments. So I feel like I have more tools at my disposal to help my patients. So in individuals with type 1 diabetes, as we mentioned, the pancreas is not making any insulin. And so they have to take insulin injections. So really the main treatment for them is to give them back insulin. So if there was a way we could give them back the beta cells of the pancreas that were making insulin, that would be like awesome. And that's what researchers have been working on. They've actually taken stem cell lines and done genetic modifications so that these stem cell lines, when implanted into a patient, can now become insulin producing beta cells. And then the next thing is to put them in a little pocket so that they don't get destroyed by the immune system, because the immune system will go, oh, what are you doing here? You don't belong. And it will try to attack it. They've tried a different ways of doing this implantation, putting like a cover around it so the blood doesn't see it, by using what's called a CRISPR technique. So you have different genetic modifications. So it's not recognized by the immune system. The body says, oh, that may be one of our own beta cells. and it doesn't destroy it. So what's really exciting to me is that they actually presented data at the Endocrine Society a couple months ago where they had 10 patients who got these stem cell transplants, and they actually showed that they were producing insulin. So it's kind of a proof of concept. Again, it's going to be several years before anything comes out as actual treatment, but it was just exciting to see that it was actually working. Still a lot of steps that need to be done, though.
Yeah, super exciting stuff. And we were talking about some of this gene replacement therapy on one of our discussions about breast cancer, and just having all these new tools that are entering the market is just huge for not only patients, but also the physicians to have this breadth of tools that are available, because every patient is unique. So every patient is going to need their own type of treatment plan. So the more options there are, the more tailored that treatment plan will be.
And that's, you know, Dr. Rob, that's what I really love about managing diabetes in today's world. I can really tailor the treatment to the patient. So when I see that patient, I can take that whole hour, dive into their lifestyle, dive into what's going on, and then actually put like a continuous glucose monitor on them and see their glucose levels, what happens when they eat, what happens when they exercise. And at looking at that data, I can really look at, where is the defect? Is their fasting glucose high? Are they high after a meal where that pancreas is not keeping up? Or is it the liver making too much sugar? Like, what is that defect? And then I can use the right medications for my individuals with type 2 to really hone in on these defects. Or if they have kidney disease, do they need an SGLT2 inhibitor, which will also help their sugars and prevent kidney problems? So I really feel in today's world and using technology, we can personalize treatment for those individuals with type 2. And then for individuals with type 1 diabetes, I mean, we've got insulin pumps, we've got different kinds of insulin pens. So we can really help to ease that burden of diabetes and try to make it easier for those individuals as well.
Absolutely. And I want to hone in on one word that you mentioned. You talked about fasting glucose. So would you mind just giving a description on what exactly is fasting blood sugar and why is that important to be on the lookout for?
Yeah, fasting glucose is important because that's really what you wake up with. And in normal individuals, the liver makes sugar when we sleep because, you know, we're not getting them in the middle of night and eating, at least most of us aren't. However, in individuals with diabetes, the liver goes, oh, you're not eating, and it makes too much sugar. So they wake up with a high glucose. And if your fasting glucose is elevated, that could be the first sign of prediabetes or diabetes. And so you then know that you need to do something to address it. So fasting glucose is really important to know where it is, and so is an A1C test, which gives you an average of your glucose levels over the last 2 months. And this can be easily done in the office with a finger stick today. So if I walk into an office, I could have a finger stick done, know what my A1C is right away, and know if I have prediabetes or diabetes, or at least if it's suggestive of that. So it's really helpful to know that.
And I also want to just mention, if diabetes runs in someone's family, what is their likelihood of getting diabetes, or what should they maybe be on the lookout for? Is there any special information that they should be giving to their primary care provider? What are your thoughts on that?
In individuals with type 2 diabetes, that's where it typically runs in the family. So in other words, if your mom or dad had diabetes, you have the gene for diabetes in you, but you don't develop diabetes until you get to an older age or you're overweight or have a very sedentary lifestyle. So if you have a family history of diabetes, you definitely want to start checking for it from age 35 onwards for sure with an A1C or a fasting glucose. But more importantly, you want to maintain a normal weight and a physically active lifestyle. So just to give you an example, let's say you're overweight and you weigh, let's say 200 pounds. So if you lost 7% of that, so that's 14 pounds, and you did 150 minutes of exercise a week, so that's 30 minutes of just brisk walking, don't need to buy a gym membership, just brisk walking 5 days a week, you would reduce your risk of developing diabetes by 58%.
Wow.
It's tremendous. And if you think of individuals, so they used to call them old, but I don't anymore, who are over 60, for them, if they reduce their weight by 7% and do that activity of 150 minutes a week, they reduce their risk by 71%.
Wow.
And yeah, it's immense. So when I see people go, yeah, my mom had diabetes, my dad, so will I. I'm like, no, it doesn't have to be that way. Just because they had it doesn't mean you will. You can take steps now so you're not following their footsteps. And that's really important to do.
Yeah, that's super important for the audience to hear that, you know, there are a lot of things that can be simply added into one's routine just to help their overall health, not only related to diabetes. We also had a question come in from the audience wondering, is it uncommon for someone to find out later on in life that they have type 1 diabetes? Do you see that often?
That's a great question, because traditionally we always thought of type 1 diabetes as something that occurs in kids who are younger, under the age of 18. But no, it does occur in older individuals as well. It's obviously not as common as in kids, but it definitely occurs. And I have seen somebody as old as 75 develop new onset type 1 diabetes. So yes, it can occur at any age.
Wow, that's good information for individuals to know. And last month, we actually had a great discussion on mental health. And one of the questions there was, how does stress play along with one's mental health and kind of make it fluctuate throughout the year? And I was just curious, does stress also play a role in one's diabetes, both maybe having an effect on them psychologically related to their condition, as well as on the severity of their condition?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, it's what we call, you know, in medical terminology, is diabetes-related distress, because diabetes doesn't disappear. It's 24/7. Like, you don't wake up and say, guess what? I don't have diabetes today. I can do whatever I want. And, you know, a classic example is a 32-year-old who saw me with two little kids whose blood sugars were really in the low 200s, not too bad, but she was in tears. She thought she would never be able to see her kids grow up. She thought she would lose her foot because her uncle had. And so we actually assessed this by something called a PAID score, and were able to break down all those barriers. So she no longer had this huge load on her head. She was worried about what people would tell her. She was worried about complications. She didn't know what to eat. She'd look at food, go, do I eat this? Do I not? And so it's really important when we see patients with diabetes, and also for the listeners out there, to know you don't have to follow this rigid diet so that your blood sugars look great, but you feel awful. You feel like your life is not there. You feel like you can't eat what you want. You can't do what you want. That's when you need to discuss those with your diabetes team, with an endocrinologist, with a diabetes educator, so you don't have that burden of diabetes on your head, and you can really live your life the way you want to, but still take care of the diabetes.
Excellent advice for someone to incorporate that information into their lifestyle to be able to have just a more well-rounded and balanced state of mind. And that kind of brings us into our last question. Pretty relevant in the age of what's going on in the world right now, but just curious, what are your takes and what have you seen in your practice related to COVID and individuals with diabetes? As early on in the pandemic, we saw that individuals who had other secondary health conditions, including diabetes, were more at risk of these extra complications when they contracted COVID. Is that still the case now? And are there any preventative measures we can take to avoid some of those extra complications?
Luckily, we've come a long way with COVID and we understand better how to treat it. Mm-hmm. So definitely for listeners with diabetes, make sure you've gotten the booster for COVID to start with, so that if you do get COVID, it will not be as severe and you will not be hospitalized. Second is, there are medications such as Paxlovid, the antivirals, that can be taken within 3 to 5 days of onset of symptoms. So if you have COVID symptoms, get tested right away. If you're positive, go ask your primary care physician or provider whether you would qualify for Paxlovid or something like that to prevent severe disease. We did, however, see in individuals under the age of 18 an increased incidence of diabetes after COVID. And so that was an observation. Again, you see, even with the certain viruses, you will see an increased incidence of type 1 diabetes as well. But for right now, it's really more preventative, getting your booster, looking at antivirals such as Paxlovid if you do get COVID, and then hopefully you can prevent those complications and hospitalizations.
Great information. Everything that Dr. Reddy talked about today, I think, will be super beneficial to the members of the community who submitted their questions or who just enjoy tuning in to learn more about the topic of the month. So with that, in honor of Diabetes Awareness Month, that's in November, stay tuned for some simple tips from Carbon Health on how to get started with their Diabetes and Metabolic Insights programs. You'll hear lifestyle advice from Carbon Health expert diabetes educators and learn more about health facts from fiction from other carbon clinicians like Dr. Reddy. So you can follow along with them at Twitter or on their carbon health blog at blog.carbonhealth.com. And I wanna give Dr. Reddy a chance to let everybody know where they can find her on social in order to stay up to date on what some of the latest trends in diabetes and endocrinology might be.
Yeah, so I'm on LinkedIn, so you can check me out on LinkedIn, as well as you can also check out the Carbon Health website for our blogs.
Perfect. So I'll make sure to put those links in the description below. And I just want to thank you again, Dr. Reddy, for taking the time to have this discussion today. And we look forward to talking to everyone at our next discussion. Enjoy the rest of your day, and we'll talk soon. Thank you. Bye.